Hey, how's it going, man? Going good. What's up?
Good, yeah. I'm just about to head home, actually.
Why are you heading home so early, dude? Have a drink with me, eh? Chill. Tomorrow's like Monday or something. I don't care.
Yeah, dude, tomorrow is Monday, and that's why I've got to head home. That's why I'm keeping it light, you know? Just keeping it down at the DC. Are you driving back home, like, tonight? Or are you staying over?
I know, yeah. I'm driving home. It's no big deal, dude. I drive home like I, you know, like, it's, I'll be fine. Don't worry about it.
Dude, you're hampered. How are you gonna drive home? Like, take a cab or something at least. Or I'll drop you, even better. Like, I'll drop you home, like, right now.
You don't need to drop me home, yeah. Chill. I've been driving like this for many years. In fact, I drive better when I'm, down a couple of drinks, you know. I'm more careful, like, I'm totally focused on the road. And, where are you? I'm totally focused on the road, and I'm driving, and I'm totally cool. Like, all my friends tell me, like, you know, they totally trust me and everything. It's cool, yeah, don't worry about it.
Have you had conversations like this with your friends? It sounds a little crazy, right? But it's so common, like, it happens to us all the time. But there are people all over the world who say the same thing. And I have to admit, I used to be that guy. Even I used to drive drunk. I'm not proud of it, but does that make it right? Of course not. Tens of thousands of drunk driving accidents and scientific studies have proven that drunk driving is ridiculously dangerous. The evidence is against that person. It's against what I used to be. And since then, I've either been completely sober when I'm driving or I start calling a cab. But what's this got to do with anecdotal evidence? Hi, welcome to Rationable. I'm Abhijit. If you're new here, this is a channel where we use science and critical thinking to fact check the world around us. So today we are talking about anecdotal evidence, which is just a fancy way of saying stuff that you swear is true. And an anecdote actually just means a story, mainly about an incident or an occurrence. We hear people telling us that I saw it with my own eyes, it worked for me, it changed my life, or I swear by it. And these anecdotes are all around us, and we encounter them every single day. It's the way we humans share information. But there's a problem when it's presented as evidence for a scientific claim. Then it's called anecdotal evidence, or argument from personal experience, which is also a logical fallacy called, you guessed it, the anecdotal fallacy, or the anecdote fallacy. This is the weakest form of evidence anyone can present for any claim they make. So, should we believe them? But is that really evidence? Let's take another story. Your favorite aunt tells you she has a sure shot treatment for migraines that involves a particular ground herb soaked in milk overnight under the light of the full moon. Now, you have to wake up at 5 a.m. and drink it. Your headache will be gone. She says it's worked for her multiple times and swears it'll work for you. Should you believe her? What's the harm? Let's dig into this, shall we? Every day, our experiences are colored by our prejudices, our belief systems, and our biases. Think you don't have biases? Sorry, buddy, but you're stuck with them. And even I am biased, and to be honest, they're the hardest damn things to counteract. That's probably how our brains are wired. We haven't evolved to think rationally and logically, but rather to survive. We're better off accepting what our friends and families believe because it leads to a better social structure than if we started ruffling feathers with unpopular beliefs. Believe me, I know that from experience. See what I did there? Now, in that vein, if we had bad experiences with doctors, we might be more open to alternative medicine. If we had strange experiences we couldn't explain, like sleep paralysis or hearing weird things at night, we might believe in the supernatural, like ghosts or spirits. So as we go through life, we live through multitudes of experiences. Each of them changes the way we think by just a little bit, and this becomes a part of our identity. Adding to this, our brains build up an incredible number of cognitive biases through our lives based on these experiences. That's why if somebody tells us we're wrong about something, our natural instincts kick in and we dig in our heels, because otherwise we become vulnerable. And vulnerability isn't suitable for survival. We feel weakened. We think the opponent has won. Coming to when I used to think that the keto diet was ultimate, people laughed at me, ridiculed me, and tried talking sense into me. But I was convinced that the science was clear and that they were just behind the times. It had become a part of my identity, even though I couldn't seem to sustain it. Maybe that was just me being weak, but it had helped me lose weight when I was consistent. Surely that meant I was right, right? You can imagine my surprise and confusion when I saw bigger, better scientific evidence saying there wasn't anything special about keto. It showed me why and how it worked. I didn't want to let it go, but I couldn't ignore the evidence. I learned later that I had massive confirmation bias and to some extent was feeling the Dunning-Kruger effect, where I lacked knowledge but was confident about my beliefs. That effect made me dig in my heels and stick to my ideas. Like this, we all suffer from a multitude of biases that affect how we think, and we make logical fallacies when we try to justify them. And this is where the anecdotal fallacy comes in. Let's go back to what I said about believing what our friends and families tell us, or for that matter, what our social, religious, or political leaders tell us. This is usually because we like hearing about people's personal stories. If you look at this from a purely evolutionary perspective, it makes sense. Science feels cold and impersonal. I think this is probably because it's such a new way of thinking relative to our existence on this planet. For hundreds of thousands of years, we've been sharing stories with each other, and sometimes believing them could mean life or death. Personal stories are easy to connect with. That's one reason I add my experiences to my writing and to my videos, because that just makes it more human and relatable. Now, we live in a time when it becomes more important than ever to figure out what's real and what's not. Just because something is right for you doesn't mean it's objectively true for everyone. This is why the anecdotal fallacy pulls us further away from the truth. Our biases and fallacies are getting a hold of us and leading many people astray, like flat earthers, anti-vaxxers, climate change deniers, and fans of alternative medicine. Anecdotes are just not good enough anymore. We have scientific and critical thinking tools that can help us find facts behind any topic. And we need to use them to present empirical, falsifiable evidence for our claims, or else we will simply lose the argument. We humans are terrible at passing out variables. If we think a particular alternative medicine works like a dream, not only our confirmation biases are kicking in, not to mention the placebo effect, but we also don't see the other variables surrounding this treatment that may also be contributing. Like that aunt who swears by the herbs in the milk. Are the herbs actually helping? What chemicals are in those herbs that could help? Can they be isolated? Was it the milk that helped ease the headache? Or was it waking up at 5 a.m.? Could the moon really be having an effect on the milk? Or was it something else outside? Could all these be having some effect or another that we don't know about? Or could they be completely benign and her headache just went away by itself? Headaches have a tendency to do that, you know. These variables can also be accounted for when each one is taken separately and tested independently, like in blinded randomized controlled trials. Anecdotes can be useful, though. I'm not dismissing your experiences and beliefs offhand. They hold value. They are a part of you and shouldn't be ignored at a personal level and a scientific one. After all, when we conduct research, say like a randomized control trial, our first source of information will be the participants' experiences. But to cancel out the biases and the other differences between all the subjects, we need to make sure we include as many people as we can in such studies. That's why research and surveys need large samples of people to be more reliable. That's also why well-researched scientific findings are also more reliable than anecdotal evidence. So whatever happened to that aunt of yours with the herbed milk potion? Should you believe her? Of course not. There are so many other variables that could have stopped her headaches. Maybe they could have gone away on their own. Plus, she's probably got a bias towards natural remedies. Her claims can be checked by scientific methods. If she can find RCTs on that herb and its consumption with milk, she should share them with you. As compelling as anecdotes can be, they shouldn't be taken as proof of anything. If they are backed up with good science, you can probably believe it. But do your own digging to get to the bottom of it. Similarly, if you see a YouTuber, an Instagram influencer, a celebrity, a friend, or a political or religious leader making big claims based on their experiences, you should be skeptical and try to find evidence for and against it. They are not reliable because they suffer from the same flaws we do. And if they provide evidence for their claims, use it to do your own research to find where the scientific consensus lies and follow those findings. If it gets turned around on you, provide the evidence. And if you don't know the answers, it's perfectly all right to say you don't know. In the worst case scenario, if you get slammed with excellent arguments and reliable evidence to prove your position is wrong, have the humility and the intellectual honesty to admit you were wrong. It's when you're wrong that you have the opportunity to learn something new, something more truthful. And learning new things will make you smarter. And we should all strive to be smarter every day. And more rationable. I will be making a series of these videos, which is going to have a lot more information on RCTs, on their pros and cons, why do randomized controlled trials need to be blinded, and a lot of other information. So if you want to check that out, make sure you hit the subscribe button and ring that bell so that you get a notification when my next video comes out. In the meantime, share this with your friends, give it a like, and let me know if you have any questions about it in the comments. Are there any experiences that you've had that have informed your beliefs? Have you tried to test them out? Let me know. Until next time, be rationable.